This is like spur of the moment here. Just suddenly, okay, hey, let's just go for it and tape. I don't know what I can say because my life is so amazing that even in your wildest dreams you cannot imagine it. So it's inexplicable to you know, really it is. The intensity and the clarity cannot really be conveyed. Cannot. It just because it's beyond what we even dream about. It's pretty cool when your life is actually way better than your dreams. That's what I'm experiencing. My dreams are getting left behind, actually. Because I'm dialing it in, the intensity. Just amazing stuff is taking place. And so it's not possible to convey it. But now, as I've said, the world set me free, and because they trusted me. So I said I would help out, and I will. That doesn't mean that I can explain exactly how I'm going to help out, but I will. I will. And the vibe I get from everybody, it's amazing. I don't want to say too much because I have to have mercy on people. I cannot explain directly what everyone's up to. I know I have in previous videos to some extent, but right now it's so clear, it'd be too strong. I have to have mercy. I'm a spokesperson for Dharmic culture, and as such, I'm very clear right now about so much about what's really going on here, and really, the explanations that have been given out in the world are not adequate. The best gurus just say practice, okay? And this is the truth. Don't worry about trying to understand what practice will lead you to. It's useless to speculate. It doesn't translate. It doesn't translate. You cannot translate into the context of doubt. So, practice is what works. And getting to practice, those who practice are dharmic. Those who don't practice are not dharmic. Even though their rhetoric may be seem very high-minded and spiritual, if they don't actually understand that practice is where it's at, and that only practice will really work, then they're not dharmic. That's why you hear the gurus always saying, you know, just repeating over and over and over, hey, you got to do this, you got to do it, you got to actually practice. And that's what most of us don't do. We're too scared. We're too scared. So the few that actually do finally start practicing and that becomes their life, then the results come. And those are the ones that are part of Dharmic culture. It's the highest social class in the world. Nothing even comes close to it. I'm a member of that class, Dharmic culture. Member of that social class of that is called Dharmic culture. You get there through practicing. And the more you practice, the more, you know, the higher you up you go in Dharmic culture. As a spokesperson for Dharmic culture, I'm in touch with the Dharma kings. I have contact with the Dharma kings. So, spokesperson answers to the gurus, the Dharma kings, and to nobody else, to nobody else. So I'm not at the beck and call of anyone in this world, not at all, not even the slightest bit. I do what the gurus tell me to do, the gurus of Dharmic culture. The Dharma kings. And as such, a perspective I have now is such that the world's perspective is so out of whack. It's too scary to people even hear it. They'll realize how out of whack they are, and they'll panic. So we don't want that. We it's a very delicate thing. We want to have mercy on everyone. So it's difficult to know what to say because my perspective has shifted so much and so fast. I see that everyone has a lot of work to do in terms of they're not even in the ballpark, actually. So I have to adjust to this new position, new responsibility as a dharmic spokesperson. Now, dharmic culture can shift locales, actually. They're capable of shifting locales. And if we need to shift to another locale, we can do this. We can do this. It, of course, the Dharma kings do it for us, essentially, but we understand and go along with it. But for most people, they say, "What? How is that possible?" And it just so Dharma. When you get really schooled in Dharmic culture and wisdom, it's not understandable to the other classes of society. They cannot understand it. But I'm on a fast right now, kind of. I have to reach a weight by March 18th, which is tomorrow. We'll probably be viewing this March 18th. I have to hit a certain weight. I was a couple days ago, I was 4 pounds too heavy. I said, "Oh boy, this is going to be tough." So to I'm really cutting back on food, and today I'm almost fasting, you might say, having some Achmaq crackers, a little butter on them, and a couple of smoothies, some blueberries and juice, but that's it. So I'm just gonna have to push through all the way till tomorrow morning and not eat anything, and I gotta hit that weight. I had an experience today that it was so astonishing, I cannot even relate it, actually. No one would believe it. But it was really, wow, got my attention, to say the least. And it scared me. It scared me. It was so surreal, it scared me, because what I was shown, what was shown was that there's going to be trouble coming in the world. Violence, anger, clashes, kind of stuff. I mean, it's just so it was so unmistakable. It scared me. So if it was just something vague and nebulous, I could brush it off. But this was just so direct. I actually had to take a side street. I mean, I had to turn off. I said, "Wow, yeah, that's amazing." It was the grace of Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, 100%, in such a shocking manner that, again, it shouldn't even be talked about specifically. It's exactly what happened, but, what ended up was I turned off this road. I said, I can't keep following this car. It's what's going on is too intense. Turned off on a road, went to a side street, and went home in a different direction. After being shown, indicated that there is trouble coming in this world. Now, we can get into something that is really astonishing if you have the nerve for it. Now, my nerves are shaking right now. I mean, there's so much information and clarity coming up. I think a lot of us are quite shocked by it all. And there's nothing wrong with us. We're just being shocked by the inrushing of history, so to speak. The inrushing of everything that's happening right now is shocking us. That's all. So I'm fine, but my nerves are. I'm on the edge. I can feel I'm on the edge, and I'm tired. I get tired and just like, wow, this is so intense. What's going on? But what happened last night was just, again, this is an example of the intensity of these times. When you really ask for grace, it's answering in astonishing ways. So, but last night, you know, it just topped everything that's come before, and everything just keeps topping what came before. So you just ride the wave, like Snapper's Rock in Australia. The wave just keeps going and going and going and going and going. There's another section. You hook up with an intersection. You hook up with it walls keeps walling up, and you just kind of disappear right out of the camera. Well, Joel Parkinson just disappeared right out of the camera. His ride just, I don't know, maybe he's still riding that wave. So it's kind of like that. We just have to keep surfing the wave of grace that's here, that's coming for us. And so what's the big to do? Well, I don't know. What did I do? I just somehow... Last night I had nothing to do. I was bored. I said, I'm right at the end. I don't have anything to do. I can't think of anything to do. And suddenly I thought, look up the rapture. Rapture 2:17. Google rapture 2:17. Or no, I said no. Jesus returns 2:17. First it was April 2:17. Then Jesus returns 2:17. And then I saw this link to a YouTube rapture. 2:17, September 2:17. I said, well, let's look at that. And so I came across this video, this website, actually, first of all, website by something like Mary Tyndale or something like that. That's a pretty good Protestant name, Tyndale, right? I think the Tyndale Bible. And so I started reading this blog post, and it was really good. It was really good because it started out by saying, you know, everybody says you can't know when Jesus is coming back or when events will take place. The Bible says so. And she said, no, wait a minute. That's totally wrong. First Thessalonians, St. Paul, I think it was like 1 through 5, something like that. And what he says, Paul very explicitly says, those that are in darkness won't know, and the troubles will come like a thief in the night upon them. But you're not in darkness. You're the children of light now because you've turned to the truth. You've turned to God. And so you no longer dwell in darkness. And because you dwell in light, you most certainly will know what's coming and see what's coming. And so it's very, very clear that those who are attuned to truth will certainly know the year and the season and maybe even the month and even the week of what's to come. But the exact hour, we may not know. Okay, the exact hour. So, I know it's very, everyone just seems to think that, you know, you hear Christians say, well, you don't know when stuff's going to happen. Not true at all. Just the opposite. You will definitely know. You will definitely know. If you're a dharmic, you will know when things are going to happen. And I've always known when stuff will happen. And at times I've pinpointed it very, very, very amazingly. But it's a little difficult to pinpoint the events in the Bible. However, there is this. I was unaware of this, but now I'm very aware of it. In Revelation, that we're told, look for the sign in the heavens. Signs in the heavens will be given, and you will then know exactly, very close to when something's going to happen, and it could very well be the beginning of the tribulation. And if you're pre-trib, that means that it very well the rapture could be around that time. If people think there's going to be a rapture just means that dharmic culture shifts to another dwelling place that Jesus has prepared. The dharmic kings have prepared another world, another dwelling place for us, where we can temporarily, or for however long, shift to that dwelling place when this world just goes through what's called the tribulation, which is really, really terrible. And we're headed for that. The trends in the world are such that we're headed directly into that. But everyone says, no, you can't know when that'll happen. Not true. Not true at all. And so what's happened is, through using these, using computers, star charts, we're able to go back and forth in history and know exactly when all the planets and the stars and the moon and the sun, where they're at. You go back, you know, as far as you want in history, I believe, and forward too. So What you have in Revelation, the famous quote in Revelation, where you'll have a virgin clothed with the sun, with the moon at her feet, and 12 stars on her head, in ready to give birth and crying out in labor pain, and when that you see that sign, then you should know that the time is upon us, something like that. So it's very, very important. What does that mean? Of course, I know that passage, but I said I don't understand what exactly they're talking about. Well, if you understand a lot of the signs given are said, look to the heavens, mean the sky, and that's where you will see the signs. So it's they say, and I believe they're accurate. They say it's talking about the following: is that the Virgin is Virgo, the constellation Virgo, and what they say is so when the sun is it clothed in the sun. When the sun is on the shoulder of Virgo, like shining over the robe of the Virgin, and then the moon is at the feet, meaning at the feet of that constellation, where the if you draw a figure, this figure of Virgo there, the moon would be at the feet position, and then at the head of the Virgo would be the constellation Leo, which has 9 stars. That's, I guess, that in the sky, the Leo is at the head of the Virgo, that constellation. But in the Bible, and ancient people called planets wandering stars. So when Venus, Mercury, and Mars are in the constellation of Leo at the Virgo's head, with the other 9 stars of constellation Leo, that gives 12 stars at the Virgin's head. And then they say that when that Jupiter goes into retrograde, it goes into the womb, where the womb would be in the constellation of Virgo, as if there's a child in the womb of the Virgin. And so when all these signs come together, that would be this telling us, that might be telling us, when the tribulation is about to start. So what they did was they went used a star chart, and they went back in history and forward in history, etc. And what they found is quite astonishing. And more than one person has done this. This is really starting to get very big on YouTube. They found that this actual situation, and by the way, Jupiter needs to be in the womb for like 40, like a normal pregnancy, like 42 weeks or something. It has to be retrograde and stay there in Virgo, in the area of the womb, for 42 weeks. So when all these things occur together, how often has that occurred in history? Well, they went back 7,000 years, and it's never occurred. It's never occurred even once. However, they go forward in history, and lo and behold, it occurs on September 23rd, 2017, for the first time in really 7,000 years of history, human history. Jupiter has been hanging out for 42 weeks in the womb of Virgo. The moon is at the feet of the constellation Virgo. The sun is right over the shoulder there, and the three planets are joining Leo for 12 planets right above her head of Virgo. September 23rd, 2017. Now, I heard this and I said, "Whoa, wait a minute." Because from a number of different sources, I have been given the September of 2017 as an extremely key important month. So there's a lot of prophecy about this month, and then to come up with this certain sign of what's in the Bible, and it is apparently pointing out the beginning of the tribulation. If you put everything else together, what's happening in the world, it all fits, doesn't it? It all fits. Including what the sign I was given by Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma today of what's coming up, and it's not good at all socially. So I said, "Wow, how extraordinary!" But then I wasn't done, so I started, put my 2 cents into all this. And what I've been experiencing is the number 144 and 44, those two numbers, and I'm not the only one. This has been over and over and over, and my attention has been brought to this so many, 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 many times. What's happening? Is this going to go cuckoo again on me or what? So, I don't have my calendar with me here, but I suddenly said, you know what? Jesus returned, for me, Jesus returned in the end of April in 2015, when I had a dream where he addressed the entire world, the spirit of everyone in the world, so that he's back to relate with us as a friend. So, I said, I wonder how many days it is from April 31st to September 23rd. And I wonder how many weeks it is. And so I started counting, and what I came upon was really astonishing. And what I also found out was from December 25th, 2015, if you use a Christian year starting in December 25th, until the year 2015, Jesus returned. So start from December 25th and go to September 23rd. You have 144 weeks. 144 weeks. And when you go from April 31st to September 23rd, or the 22nd, the 21st is Rosh Hashanah, actually. It's 144 days. It's 144 days to Rosh Hashanah. This was, I think it's the 21st of September. And a lot of the prophecies that Rosh Hashanah in September is right in the time frame of the tribulation beginning, because the trumpets sound, the trumpets sound on Rosh Hashanah. Also talk of a jubilee, the jubilee year. That's like some special number of jubilees since the first jubilee or something, and that's the exact number, that very date. You have stuff coming from all directions. It's really amazing, and that you have the 144 that's coming there. I also got 44 somehow. I can't quite remember how I did that. What is it? I can't quite remember exactly. Anyway, the synchronicity it stacks up so strongly with 144, and of course 144,000 are supposedly those who will be saved at the end times. 144,000. So there's the 144 right there. I say, So, there is something. That makes one just pause and say, wow. So we'll see how it goes now. I was told to get in shape, get in really good shape, right weight, get ready by March 18th, which is this day now. Just ready for you know, before the first day of spring. And I hopefully I reach that goal. Hopefully I reach that goal. As far as, mentally, physically, just in every which way, I made a massive push to be ready. And it's certainly the kind of recognitions and clarity I'm having is, for me, is unprecedented. I have to go gently here. I have to go gently. So there's some stuff that's coming to light right now. And that September 23rd, 2017 is absolutely something that is worth noting. And we'll see how it goes. It's in the flow of my consciousness now. I'm aware of it. It's also very amazing that those who work on from the angle of the geniuses who work on the asteroid problem, they have said that the window of likely getting hit is, they mapped it out. September 2017 was kind of the end of a window of 2017, but they say that's one of the likely times that we could get hit by asteroids. And then, if not, then 2017, then year, several years later, a number of years later, we're sort of in this danger period as far as asteroids being pushed in from the Oort cloud and the Kuiper belt, wherever they hang out there. For certain forces periodically push them into the inner solar system. This has been going on for, eons, so to speak. And they say that we're in a real, real, real dangerous period right now. So, and that just happens to be September. They noted it 2017. So there you have, the tribulation. They said they see something, a third of the stars fall from the sky, a flaming mountain coming in into the sea, turning the sea red, all this stuff. Well, it could be that's where the tribulation gets underway. It really could be. I wouldn't doubt it, and if it did, I'd say, well, of course. And hindsight would tell you, absolutely, we were aware of it ahead of time. And I'm seeing just how messed up the minds of the unrepentant are. Just and how, wow, just how messed up they are, and it's quite shocking. Quite shocking. But not to worry, because they're not completely messed up. They're able to, I was able to get through to them to the extent they set me free. The world set me free. So we're, we're not, totally deranged. We're just badly, badly disoriented and confused. The spirit, it really is. But it's still spirit. And so spirit can still recognize if someone can really is dedicated and committed, compassionate and clear about it all, they can say, okay, we don't understand what's going on. We really don't understand, but we feel that you are going to be able to help us out with this. So you can go. Like that. It's like the world is like a, someone who commandeers, play, does something that takes over a bus or a plane or whatever, holds everybody hostage. The world's hold, if you come in this world as dharmic, the world tries to hold you hostage to try to force God to fixate the mind. And so they don't like letting hostages go. So I've been held hostage my whole life here, actually. I've been held hostage. Really, this is the truth. I mean, my whole life feels like I've been a hostage. But the amazing thing was they let me go without, demanding anything, except they just said, promise us you'll go to the Dharma Kings and ask them to help us. That's it. That's all. That's the only stipulation they gave me. Just do that for us, please. So, I'm no longer a hostage to the world. And I'm coming out of that hostage consciousness, that when people are taken hostage and they're abducted and they're held hostage for years and years and years and maybe decades. It's a tough thing when you're finally set free. It's like, it takes a while to get back to yourself, and stop all the, what they call it, that you identifying with your captors, trying to get along with them and make nice them and survive. You sort of adopt a persona that get along persona. So what I found is since I've been released from being a hostage, is that I'm starting to recover my clarity and adamant nature, and it's coming on stronger and stronger. And this is the way I really am. And I say, wow, this is great. I mean, wow. I'm very, very dharmic. This is what's happening. And I can say stuff and just tell it like it is. Say, hey, it's time to turn the page to a new chapter. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. That's all there is to it. And just lay out black and white, very crisp, clear, black and white, no wiggle room at all. This is what has to be done. So I'm very dharmic. And that's coming back to me. It's coming back to me very fast. And it needs to come back very fast. And I realized why people were kind of so shocked by me when I was young. I just said, look, you're wrong. I'd say to these spiritual people, look, you don't have a clue. You're just conceptualizing it all. And really, once we give up hallucinating the absence of God, there's nothing you can say about it. There's nothing that you can say when your practice is truly effective and you overcome, your continuity fear. There's nothing that can be said about truth that can be translated effectively into words or concepts. It's not possible. Not possible. So, again, forget about trying to conceptualize truth. That's a waste of time. Total waste of time. Just practice on continuity fear, on familiarity bias, and use the accept your identity as wow. And this enables you to really, you call it the peace. Jesus called it the peace that passeth all understanding. So you can't understand it. You cannot. So don't even try. Don't even try. There's nothing that can be said about truth that's understandable. It's very important dharmic information to hear this. So it's all about practicing. That's what it's all about. So all this stuff that the rhetoric, spiritual rhetoric that people are saying, that's not dharmic. It's still not dharmic. It's not. It's not. So you hear stuff like this, and you're like, whoa, But this is very mild. I mean, turning the chapter, we absolutely have to go into a new chapter. And all the stuff that's happened before, time to move on from it. Time to move on from it. Didn't serve us well at all. We lost our spirit, lost its nerve in 1973. And backed away. It couldn't handle a familiar problem. It doesn't understand a familiar problem. So it was not. Spirit did not properly prepare. It tried to get free, tried to set down, hallucinating the absence of God, trying to fix it, and trying to, try to fixate the mind to keep that hallucination in place. It tried, it made a big effort, but it lost its nerve, and then retrenched itself in trying to champion fixating the mind again. And so that's what's happened since 1973, last 44 years. There's 44 again. Have been hell. I mean, it's just been a free fall into hell towards the tribulation times. The spirit lost its nerve. But we got to turn the chapter on that. Say, okay, you lost your nerve. No problem. We'll help you get it back. Because we are a spirit. We're not female or male at all. Not at all. Those are just death devices we're using. Devices to try to fixate the mind. Those scapegoats or the excuses for our own mentality, our own, what we're trying to do, but we're spirit, we're spirit. So spirit lost its nerve. Bodies are just puppets. They're neutral, they're inert. And so the last 44 years, they have been this free fall back into materialism, into darkness, into bad, bad, bad darkness. But again, no worries, because I've been able to see through it all. And it's easy. It's easy. You just have to realize that familiarity is the issue. As soon as you realize that, you're in a different chapter. You're in a totally different chapter. You've turned the page. You've turned into, gone into a new chapter. And the stuff that came before, you start losing interest in it. You really do. You just say, wow, I didn't realize what the problem really was. And I didn't realize how severe it was. But now that I do, I can regain my nerve. I, as spirit, can regain my nerve. And you really start losing interest in all the spiritual stuff that the people are pumping out. That's really not it. It's really not it. Practice is it. And you can't say anything about reality. The peace of God, what can you say? The peace of God, the imperceptible peace of God. It doesn't mean anything unless you've experienced it. It really doesn't. When you experience it, you say, oh, so this is it. I mean, there's no way you could ever convey that into the confused, fearful, biased belief system mind. There's no way. There's no way to convey it through concepts. It's pointless to keep struggling in that way. So it's just, you start practicing and you start losing interest in the whole spiritual scene and all that stuff. It just, you see, oh, that's not it. And so we've been there, we've done that, we've gone through what we've gone through. We lost our nerve, spirit lost its nerve in 1973, and that's what happened. So, but we have to turn the page on that to say, okay, water under the bridge, been there, done that. Now time to get down to work. Get down to business. We have the answers. It's very simple. But the simplicity will only be revealed when we remove the obstacles to it. And the obstacle, there's only one obstacle, which is familiarity bias. We're biased towards doubt. We're biased towards, trying to fixate the mind. We're biased to what we're familiar with. That's it. And so you can't. We don't really want to stay in fear with this. We don't want to. Spirit doesn't want to, but it doesn't understand where this fear is coming from and why. And so it keeps thinking, well, there must be some reason to be afraid, and there's not. It's just familiarity. We're afraid of the unfamiliar, even though it may be perfect. We're still afraid of it. So there's no reason. Why we seem to be stuck, other than it's a familiarity issue. So all this attempt to intellectualize it out ultimately doesn't succeed. We have to really get to full stop in the wow practice. Now, you can use Ramana's way too, is I. Just everything's just I. Here we say, wow. Same practice. Just whatever thought arises, just say I. Now he said, well, find the I. Find the where it's coming. He points to the I. Just point to the I. No matter what arises, point to the I. Point to the I. Point to the I. Same thing here. It's exactly the same, really, as what Ramana Maharshi advises us as the approach we need to use. We just point to the wow and just say, wow, that's it, wow. All past is the wow, all future is the wow, all now is the wow, that's it. This is super skillful practice. When everything begins to settle down when we practice this way, and we begin to lose interest, and fear begins to dissipate. And I've explained how this works many, many, many times. It's just, it's helpful to realize that this is the practice. Super skillful means. Get used to not trying to define. Okay, Our problem is we've tried to fixate what we are, which is perfect freedom. And, you know, perfect freedom doesn't have any pattern at all. How can perfect freedom pattern itself after anything? Right? Is there something that can pattern itself after some form? How can, you know, think about perfect freedom. There's no pattern. There's no definition, no pattern that can possibly be pointed to, really. Right? No matter what arises, it still doesn't set a pattern for perfect freedom. So we can have all this ornamentation of spaciousness arising, but none of it ever patterns us. Even if we keep the same appearing for a trillion moments, you know, we're still absolutely free, and it is not we are not patterned after anything. Okay, we are not. And freedom is inherent intrinsicness. It's not caused by anything. Okay, it's not caused by anything. Freedom is reality. So reality is not caused by something. It's not caused. Okay, we're beyond causation. Reality is totally beyond the whole notion of causation. But we are for perfect freedom. That is the nature of God, that is reality. And there isn't some other cause of it, you see. So isness or being and cause are in your mind, we've gotten confused and think they're the same. It's not really the same. When we say cause, say, well, this caused that. But reality is just God. It is God itself. There's not God causing reality. God is reality. There's only the isness of reality. That's all there is. There's nothing causing reality. So, totally non-causative. And when we can accept this, then we're back home and we're invited to it. Yeah. But this type of clarity I'm having now is only gotten to by very skillful means of practice. And all I do is, wow, that's it. Pretty much, so. And then affirmations like I'm already there. Wow. There's nothing I need to do. Wow. Reality's totally uncaused. Wow. So I don't need to wait on any cause at all. Wow. Like that. You know. So we have the skillful practice here, very much so. And so I've been doing it for now quite some time. You know, I don't know how many years, but it's been quite some time, actually, that I've really been practicing. And I remember I shifted over to practice. I said, okay, well, I've got to start doing this now. And from then on, it's just been, you know, so tremendous, the progress, such that I've been able to become very skillful and clear about practice and practicing. So that, you know, that's very dharmic and helpful. It's very helpful. Now, the confusion in everyone's mind is so bad, so extreme, that it's a tough thing. Even those, there are many who profess non-dual understanding and non-dual experiences and who do teaching and stuff, they're also still extremely confused, actually. And it's not easy to tell them that. Really, it's not. There, you know, it's like the five blind people in the tent with the elephant, and it's dark, and they're grabbing a hold of some part of the elephant saying, I got it. I know what it is. But it's not, the elephant is not, you know, its ear. You know, it's, you have to see the totality, and you have to widen out the responsibility. You have to accept responsibility for helping others, like Bodhisattva. Be a Bodhisattva, and when you do that, that's when you start seeing the bigger picture of it all. And then it's very different than what's being presented as contemporary spirituality. They don't have it right, actually. They think they do. They think they have the concepts, but they're off. They're way off the tracks, actually. Way off track. They say those that know don't say, because you can't say what it is. You cannot say anything that translates properly or effectively about abidance and reality. And so you have to, as Rana said, the best teaching is silence. Absolutely. That translates the best. Now, you could say all sorts of stuff. You could say the peace of God, but silence translates the best. Again, thanks to Ram Maharshi. He's in the house. They're all in the house. The Dharma Kings are in the house right now. So, you know, people have experience. They write a book, and I say, whoa, 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 whoa. Just keep wowing the fact that you had an experience. Keep wowing it. Whatever arises, just wow it. Keep wowing it. Stay humble. Stay humble and keep wowing it. Or keep eyeing it. Everything is I. Whatever arises, I. That's just a bridge, just like wow is a bridge. Blocks panic. The world's in panic right now. World's in panic. Wow, some of this amazing stuff's happening. I went to the store today, and there was this employee there that I'd seen before, and he was singing about Jesus before. I thought he must be on drugs or something. Maybe he was, but I went back today, and he was wearing this shirt, and it said, praise the Lord on the front of it. And on the back, it said, repent. Repent. And I said to him, hey, I like your shirt. It said, repent. That's great. We all love repent. He says, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it sort of rang his bell like that. He said, wow, somebody actually said something like that and praised me for this. And so then I'm waiting for him. And then he says to me, hey, you need to park over there on the side. When you're getting this stuff, when you're picking up this material, you need to be over on the side there. I said, okay, I'll move to the side. I moved to the side. Pretty amazing, huh? Move to the side. Move off to the side. So he told me. And then later in the day, when I had this experience that was Sri Sri Anandamayamanda house, to say the very least, in the most stunning way, I turned off on a side street. I had to turn off on a side street. I went to the side. Don't be in the mainstream of contemporary spirituality. You know, this is what's being told to me, and now I'm seeing why they don't have it really nailed down at all. And I've not been able to help anyone really. Those who think they know that they won't listen. They won't listen. It's better to be ignorant sometimes than to have a little bit of knowledge, because then they get big headed and. You know, it just they think they fixate on it. I said, this, I think I got it. You know, no. I've had experiences. You know, I've had tremendous breakthrough experiences. So many. But I say I don't have it, because only abidance is it. That's it. Only abidance. In that which really silence is the best communication of, and nothing else is it. So if you're not in that, then you don't have it. And you may have quite a lot of familiarity bias to still to go. And you can write book after book after book, you still don't have it. I mean, how many books have been written throughout history, spiritual books? How many of them were really written by those who really were in abidance? Very few. Very, very, very few. Oftentimes, those in abidance don't write books. But sometimes they do. I mean, maybe, you know, maybe the best, one of the best is Longchenpa, you know, and then Jesus with A Course in Miracles, which is, you know, just amazing, to say the very least. So it doesn't matter, you know, how many books somebody's written, how many lectures they've given, how much satsang they've given. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. There are many giving satsang who don't have it. They don't have it. Because what I'm seeing very clearly now, way beyond that, how they talk and teach, and way beyond that. And I don't even have it, abidance. But I'm aware, very aware, I don't have the abidance yet. So I stay in the wow. I stay in the wow. I say, wow, I keep, you know, the path is still very intense. People have these breakthrough experiences. They form a concept of it, a structure around it, and they may be very charismatic, and so they're able to teach then because of the very charismatic personalities. But they don't have it. They don't have it. Not in abidance. So we just, dharmic culture is about remaining meek and humble. Keep trying to be of service to others and work on your practicing. Keep working on your practicing. I love the Tibetan Buddhists because even the ones that have Rigpa, they've to some extent, I don't know. I mean, even the high lamas, they still practice. They still practice intensely. Setting the example. They set the example for everyone. You know, they keep the humility very strong. And they bow to their gurus and say, you know, I'm nothing compared to you. I'm nothing. I'm just a, you know, like Jamyang Khyentse Shogyi Lodro, his humility is amazing. You know, he says, I don't have anything to say. They asked him to teach us something. He says, well, why do you ask me? I'm a miserable idiot. I don't know anything. I'm driven by, you know, hope and fear and all this stuff. And then finally, they prevailed upon him, say, well, you know, if you really insist, I'll write something. And then, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da, and it's like, you know. In a couple sentences, he says it all. That's it. And then back to, you know, I don't know anything. What a great example that is. Listen, I was listening to, again, Dion today, Dion DiMucci. Donna, the prima donna. I went on to that song, so I listened to it. Holy cow. Those songs, I listened over and over and over and over. Man. It's hard to explain. I suddenly heard Dion's songs as very, very dharmic. Suddenly, all the lyrics, I suddenly said, oh my gosh, this is about the spirit. Like, the wander is about freedom. You know, it's about spaciousness and freedom. I never get fixated. I find myself falling for a girl. I pack up my, hop up my car, and I go around the world. You know, meaning, don't get fixated by nature. Don't get fixated by appearances. I love them, I leave them. They don't even know my name. In other words, I can't be defined. I cannot be defined. I'm spirit. I cannot be defined. And you know, the pretty girls are ornamentation and spaciousness. Ornamentation, spaces of what's arising as out of as creative display. But so, you know, that we've got one on our right arm, one on our left arm. We never settle down. We never settle down. We're always free. We never get fixated. We never are caused. There's no causation for freedom. And if you plug in high dharmic understanding into the lyrics of that song, it fits perfectly. It's just astonishing. And the other songs too. So many of his songs, you plug in high dharmic clarity, and it fits beautifully. Like, the songs are just exactly about that. He says, I don't know where he came up with this, but he was inspired. I know he didn't write the songs necessarily, but he whoever wrote them and the performance and everything, very, very dharmic. And so it just became so clear about all this today, about nature and the symbology of nature. Of course, if I start talking about this, it'll be too much for you, so I won't. But it's all there. Anyway, listen to the Dharma Prima Donna. And pretty interesting. I did some more research on this, and I said, who really sang backup on all these songs? So I checked out the Del Satins, who came in after the Belmonts, and it turns out Del Satins were the ones who sang background on almost all his big hits. And this is never talked about. everyone thinks it's beyond the Belmonts. It's not the Belmonts. And they did. I wonder why. You know, and I'm not sure if they did. Why Do Fools Fall in Love? They might have done that anyway. They did. But the big hits like The Wanderer, Run Around Sue, Love Came to Me, Donna and Diane and Sandy and Wonder Why, or what was it? The other one is this Little Girl and all this stuff. Those are the Del Satins, and they were not credited. They were not credited. They were just hired by the studio just to sing on these songs, and they were paid, but they weren't credited. And that's maybe the best background singing work that I've ever heard. That's how good it is. I'm listening to it more and more carefully. And it's like five guys from New York City. Man, were they great. And then you throw in Dion, and then the content of the song, and then if you look at it dharmically, you know, it's like, wow. This, the wonder why the Holy Spirit said you need to start listening to Dion. Let's listen to this stuff and tell me what you think of it. The Holy Spirit says, why don't you tell me what your opinion is of this music? That's how the Holy Spirit works. It kind of challenges a little bit. Say, I want to hear what you feel about this music. Let me know. So I said, okay, I'll give it a try. And now I'm saying, oh my gosh, this is quite astonishing, actually. Love Came to Me. I lived in dreams, but strange as it seems, love came to me. It opened my eyes. Now I realize love came to me. Love came to me. Feels so good. Love came to me. But this time it's real. This time it's real. Yeah. Love came to me, but this time it's real. I was in dreams before, but love came to me anyway, even though I was in dreams, and opened my eyes. And this time it's real. It's like, wow. You know, that's like what we're talking about here with this high dharmic teaching is abidance. Yeah. That cannot be spoken about in a way that's effectively, cannot effectively translate. Whatever said about it cannot be effectively translated. Cannot. Don't ever think it can be. Very important to hear this. And it's taken me a long time to get to this. But you can gradually keep gravitating towards this. Everything's a struggle on the path because we're so out of whack, so convoluted, and none of the convolution has any value to it at all. None of it. How are we doing here? Doing pretty good here. Doing well. 57 minutes. Whew, man. Very intense, huh? Okay. I'll see if I can put a an intro to this video, so I better end it right here. I don't want to overwhelm you. I know everyone's nerves are on edge, but you just get the feel from me here that's like, wow, you know? Yeah, really like, wow, that's it. Okay, let's stop the catcher at this point. Wow.